safety is off. There's a round in the chamber. This is Armed Alabama, sponsored by McCoy Outdoor Company, Mobile's hometown full-line outdoor sporting products and gear store, an interactive talk show discussing self-defense, product reviews, shooting tips, safety, and more. Your calls, comments, and texts welcome at 343-0106. Now, here are your hosts, retired judge and certified NRA instructor, Rusty Johnston, and certified NRA law enforcement instructor, Adam Strange.
They're gonna pry these guns right out of my hands when they come to take them away. I believe in the rights that my fathers gave me when he signed the Constitution that day. No misguided president or crooked politician with a greasy pocket be spared. When the hard-working man gets tired of your cry, it's gonna rain wrath, beware. Don't tread on me, I'm American free. You're not gonna take it away. I stand up to fight for my freedoms and rights. That's a price you'll have to pay. Don't tread on me, I'm American free. Red-blooded to the core. You ain't ever had a fight in your life like a fight that you're champ for.
All right, welcome to Armed Alabama, the two-hour show where we talk about self-defense, firearm ammo selection, home protection, concealed carry, training, proper range etiquette, and the law. Glad you could join us tonight. I'm Adam Strange. I hold 11 different firearm certifications, including NRA law enforcement instructor certifications for handgun, shotgun, and patrol rifle. Joining me tonight is former prosecutor for the state of Alabama in Baldwin County and municipal court judge for Mobile and Saraland, Matt Green. Glad you can join us, Matt.
Great. Thanks for having me. And I likewise hold several height and hair certifications, but nowhere near the pedigree that you have. I'm just excited to be sitting here next to you tonight, Adam.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you so much for joining us and filling in for the judge.
He's not here tonight, and he asked me to help out and talk a little bit about the law and share some thoughts about where we may be going in the next 4, maybe 8 years and the current state of firearm law.
Thank you. There's a lot going on right now. If you have any questions regarding purchases over Christmas or maybe Christmas presents or something, maybe that Santa Claus put under the tree for you pertaining to firearms and ammunition, by all means, give us a call. It's 251-343-0106, and we'll be glad to answer your questions if you have anything, questions that you may have regarding anything that you got new over the holidays. Like we said before, it's not Christmas unless you have a firearm or something under the tree. So now's a good time. If you have any questions regarding that, definitely give us a call. Be sure and check us out on Facebook. It's Armed Alabama Radio, FM Talk 106.5. We are broadcasting live on Facebook. So be sure and go there and check us out. You can check us out on Twitter, Armed Alabama, FM's Armed Alabama 106.5. And also check us out on our webpage, and that's armedalabama.com. If you miss any of our previous shows, you can go to our website and you can listen on podcasts at any time. Also, you can tune in to us via TuneIn app on your phone, and you can listen as well as the 106.5 webpage, which is simulcast during the show all the time. So there's lots of different ways to listen, and you can even watch our previous shows on YouTube. We have an Armed Alabama YouTube channel. Go there, like, and subscribe. And you can listen to all of our previous broadcasts that we do, our Facebook Live broadcast. If you can't listen to it or watch it during the time of the show, you can go to our YouTube channel, Armed Alabama, and you can watch our previous broadcasts. So we've got a lot of information for you tonight, and just about every night we come to you. And we want to thank our sponsors and advertisers, and those are David Parnell at Palmer's Toyota, Dr. Justin Foster at Foster's Chiropractic of Tillman's Corner, Grayson, David Grayson of Grayson Heating and Air, McCoy Outdoors, of course, and joining with me tonight, the law office of Matt Green is a proud sponsor, and we're glad to have you with us tonight, Matt.
Sounds like a distinguished full-service law boutique.
Absolutely. If you would like to advertise your business on Armed Alabama Radio, be sure and contact us. You can email me, adam@armedalabama.com. We would love to add you to our distinguished list of advertisers and sponsors. And also, if you yourself would like to sponsor our show, you can go to armedalabama.com and you can click on the sponsorship. It's Patreon, and you can go on there and you contribute to the show. And we'd be more than glad to have you as a contributor. And we've got some different things that we can give you as a sponsor. So we appreciate that. And that go to our website, armedalabama.com, and that's the link there is Patreon, and you can go and you can contribute. So we appreciate you doing that. I hope you had a good holidays, a good Christmas, good New Year. I know we did. Watched a lot of news, CNN, Fox News, and so forth. And one of the things that absolutely just struck me, of course, we've been talking about it over the last several months, is talking about the crime rate in Chicago, mainly the homicides. So Chicago, Illinois, filled out the 2016 year with 762 homicides for the year, which is just unbelievable. And that is Obama's home city and home state. And he will be given a speech. Was it his farewell speech will be given from Chicago? Is that right, Matt?
I think that's where he started. Or gave his the election night event they had there in Chicago.
Yeah,
I remember
yeah.
that Oprah and all his major supporters were there, and I think that's probably where he'll give his farewell speech. I wonder if he will warn against foreign entanglements like our first president did.
Yeah.
I seriously doubt that, unfortunately.
No, I don't think so. So I think with the gun violence there, and also the gun violence at homicides, increase across the U.S. was double digit. And I think you can owe that to this part of Obama's legacy.
Well, yeah. I mean, you look at, you know, his legacy before the highest court in the country has been abysmal. In fact, one of the most restrictive gun laws that made it to the United States Supreme Court, the city of Chicago versus or McDonald versus city of Chicago, basically struck down the way they did. The United States Supreme Court struck down a municipal firearm regulation and for the first time held that the Second Amendment, which was incorporated through the 14th Amendment to apply against the state and local governments, in this instance, the city of Chicago. So it's not surprising that you see, you know, these the high homicide rates and some of the most restrictive gun laws, but these municipalities, particularly in Illinois, are still pushing the envelope. And the thrust of the Heller decision, which was really what first
the United
States Supreme Court recognized the Second Amendment as a fundamental right.
Applying to the state.
Right.
Yep.
The lower circuits are really, many of the lower circuits are not enforcing the full provisions that the Supreme Court have held that should be applicable. And so there's significant litigation going on right now in the Second Amendment in the lower circuit courts of appeals.
That's a good point. And just like you said, I think it's connected. I think the connection of restrictive gun laws within Chicago, Illinois, and the amount of homicides there is connected. The judge and I met. I don't know if you got a chance to meet John Lott when he was here a few years ago.
Great guy.
And he wrote.
Fascinating.
Yes, it is. He very much is. He wrote a good book, More Guns, Less Crime. And I think this is a lessons learned for Chicago.
You're right. A lot of his publications and books and studies are actually cited in some of these court cases. So I think he's recognized in many jurisdictions as an authority in the area. And Mobile and Judge Johnston were lucky to have him down. A couple years ago at Gunport, where he came down there.
Yeah, I got a chance to meet him then, and I got his autograph.
Yeah, I did too. Interesting. Yeah. Fascinating guy. I wish we could have publicized it better, but it was he's kind of on the, I guess, in the forefront of the firearms and self-defense constitutional law realm.
Right, right. One of the things that wasn't of note is one of the CDP leaderships, the Chicago Police Department leadership, I think it was a union rep there, was stating that maybe contributing to this high homicide rate is the fact that officers are scared to go the extra step to maybe to stop and frisk somebody or maybe do something that might put them in a possible compromising situation. And they feel, the officers feel like that they're being targeting. So we'll have this and more when we come back with Armed Alabama.
This program is a production of Armed Alabama, LLC. The comments and views of the hosts are those of Armed Alabama, LLC, for which it is solely responsible. The view and comments of the callers, guests, and texters do not necessarily represent the views of the sponsors or advertisers of Armed Alabama, LLC, or of Armed Alabama, LLC, Bigler Broadcasting, LLC, FM Talk 106.5, or WAVH. No comments from Judge Rusty Johnston should be taken as legal advice, but as educational information. Judge Johnston is not engaged in the practice of law and should not be sought out to answer legal questions off the air. Seek legal advice from a qualified attorney who knows the complete specifics of your legal matter.
Step up to the firing line. Armed Alabama is back. Questions, comments, and texts at 343-0106.
All right, welcome back to Armed Alabama. And again, joining me tonight is Matt Green, former state prosecutor and current, we'll say, president of your law office.
That's right. President and CEO.
Important.
That's right.
Important title. And we're so glad you could join us tonight. Thank you, Matt. So just before we went to the break, we were talking about Chicago, and we're talking about the crime rates there and possible reasons why and the way and how the CDP feels about it, the Chicago Police Department, how the officers, they feel that they're being targeted not only by the public with very malicious intent, but also state and local officials and the news media as well.
Yeah, what you're referring to was what they call the Ferguson effect.
Yes.
It's kind of a chilling of the of law enforcement's enforcement of the law. And I think it's certainly It's manifested itself in many ways, and sadly, what you'll see, I think, and I think it's been borne out, and it's at least here in our local police force, is that people that would otherwise envision themselves having careers in law enforcement have just decided to opt for another or other professions.
Yeah, and, absolutely.
And it's also caused people that maybe not shouldn't have any business in law enforcement having positions with law enforcement. But you're right. I think, and I hate to say it's because of this administration, but I don't think necessarily this administration has done anything to further trust in law enforcement. And in some instances, there's issues where their trust hasn't been earned. And traditionally, we sought relief in the judiciary and in the courts. And it seems of late, riots and and anarchy have been the impulse of the masses.
I think it's safe to say that there's a certain amount of contempt as well with this administration. I mean, one of the first things, first contacts or statements made by the president as president was that the police acted stupidly. And this was talking about the arrest, or no, it's the questioning of one of Obama's former colleagues.
Oh, yeah, that's Professor.
Professor, yeah.
Was it Gates, or I can't remember?
Yeah, that's exactly what, Gates. And
then they had the famous beer summit after that.
Yeah, absolutely. But, I mean, his first comment on this was the police department acted stupidly, and that was, you know, from the president of the United States. So
traditionally, they kind of, you know, you would think that the chief executive would not insert himself in a purely local matter.
Absolutely.
And I think that's kind of been the unwritten code. But, he did in that instance. And I think he did before all the facts came out. And I think it didn't make him look presidential.
No. So speaking of local, I'm sure as a lot of people are aware, kind of following the news and following crime rates for here in Mobile, there's been 44 murders in Mobile this year, and 12 of those remain unsolved.
It's incredible, and I don't think I mentioned this to you earlier. I have a client, I'm not going to say who it is, a client of mine whose son was murdered not too long ago this past summer. And in fact, A&E has sent a film, a crew from one of their shows called The First 48, and they've been in town since June, I believe, and following the Mobile Police Department and several detectives in investigating a lot of these homicides. And I found it curious that Mobile was one of the cities that they chose. When you think about Chicago or...
Yeah, it was 762 murders.
I had tweeted about it.
That's paltry in comparison.
Yeah.
Of course, each murder is terrible.
Sure.
But it's absolutely paltry in comparison to 762.
But, you know, and there were some of these murders in Mobile have been particularly high profile in the sense that they're involved victims that aren't engaged in any type of at-risk conduct, like the young lady that was driving to work one day in the early morning hours and was just brutally assassinated. And it's shocking. It just seems like it's the assailants and the defendants seem to get younger and younger. They're in their teens. And my friend, whose son was murdered, one of the shooters, there were two 17-year-olds, one of which was out on bond for robbery in the first degree at the time of the shooting. And you just wonder, what in the heck is going on here? And I mean, and you can understand a little bit of the concern with the people that have particularly the progressives and liberals, they have a gut reaction, and their gut reaction is that the way to handle it or the proper mechanism of resolving these issues is through more firearm regulations. And I just don't think that that's necessarily the proper way to resolve it.
No, I think one could argue and necessarily argue that, John Lott, we just talked about him, more guns, less crime.
Mm-hmm.
And I think those statistics hold true. And for me and myself, which is why we always advocate is being proficient with your firearm for your personal self-defense, whether it be inside the home or outside the home. If you're carrying concealed, then that would be outside the home, and you need to be proficient with that firearm, proficient at presenting that firearm, meaning a good, correct draw to be able to utilize that weapon effectively.
The chief of police, Chief Barber, I think he's probably one of the best chiefs we had in a long while.
Yes.
And he's expressed concern, particularly with the access of these youths to firearms. And they did I think one of the local affiliates, Fox affiliates, did a special, but they interviewed some of these young folks who shot and killed people. And they talked about, some were as young as 12 or 13 when they first had access to a gun. And, the first reaction when they get involved in any type of conflict seems to be the brandish a firearm. In the old days, you go behind the gym.
Yep.
And everybody
go behind the gym.
Do some haymakers. But nowadays, with people don't want to get in. And the chief said this when he addressed some citizens not too long ago, that when they interviewed these young perpetrators, that one of the reasons why they're so quick to resort to firearm violence is because they don't want to be involved in a fight where they get whooped, and it's on Facebook, on social media, on Snapchat, and it's permanent, and it's a source of humiliation, and that is more frightening than them than the consequences of shooting and killing someone. That's incredible when you think about it.
It really
but
is.
Maybe it's just that their minds aren't developed enough to totally take in the full ramifications and consequences of their act, which is why the chief has been very good about this education component and engaging the young folks. But it's incredible, and these the number of homicides in Mobile is going up significantly this year as compared to prior years. So you're talking about over 40 homicides in Mobile.
Mm-hmm.
And the mayor's initiative is to make Mobile one of the most safest and family friendly communities in the country. So it's been very difficult to make that happen.
And it's just something that not only the local leadership, local law enforcement, but to everybody as citizens of this area, is to be able to contribute to that and helping and supporting law enforcement and supporting local officials. Also in the news is the New Year's Eve attack that took place in Istanbul, Turkey, was Now, I think ISIS has claimed responsibility for the attack, which is the first one in the Turkey that they've claimed the responsibility of. And the shooter took 39 lives in that attack and wounded 70. So it was pretty significant. I just seen a limited amount of video on it. But from my first impression when I seen the video a couple of days ago is that the individual looked like he had prior training, the way he walked with the firearm, the way he moved, and he kind of leaned in, was slicing the pie when he first engaged the officer and the security guard there at the facility. And of course, I tried to find out more information about it today and yesterday, is that one of the things I found is some of the news reports has stated that he possibly was trained and fought in Syria. So maybe my first thoughts, maybe, yeah, that indeed he was somebody that had been trained or received training, just the way he moved and utilized that firearm.
And yet another undeclared military action or police action by the United States. You know, and Bush, the elder Bush, did the same thing in terms of expanding executive power. We have all these undeclared wars where we're sending American troops abroad.
Yeah.
And I think that may be an issue that the War Powers Act, I think that may be an issue before too long. That may come before the Supreme Court, but we're right now. I think you're looking at blowback.
Yeah, yeah, and it's, so Turkey, as part of NATO, is in Syria. They have forces in Syria.
And the Russians are there as well. Correct?
Yeah, yeah, and so this is why these attacks are taking place. I think Turkey, just for the sheer essence of it, is very close to Syria. It's easy to get inside Syria. I mean, get inside Turkey, and I think that's why these acts are taking place. And of course, you mentioned Russia. They had Russia ambassador was assassinated within Turkey by a police officer. You know, so somebody that was trained. He was I don't know if he's Istanbul police officer, but he was a police officer within city of Turkey somewhere within the country. I can't remember right off the bat where that assassination took place.
And you remember not too long ago, a political assassination ignited a world war.
Yeah. The first world war.
That's right.
Yeah.
The war to end all wars, right?
Right. Which it really didn't. Which maybe actually contributed to the second world war.
There you go.
If you look at the things that the policies that were put in place and also not only the policies, but the actually actions of appeasement by different governments within Europe leading up to World War II. So another thing too is that reports were that he was the attacker was actually throwing what looked like explosive devices, maybe grenades or something like that. I couldn't verify that today in the news, but they said that he did that. He threw what looked like an explosive device each time before he reloaded. So to kind of keep people at bay back while he reloaded a magazine on his weapon and then started shooting again. So people were taking cover as he was throwing those items.
How long do you think someone like that would last at, say, the flea market on Schillinger's Road on a random Saturday?
I don't know. Oh, you'll get this and more when we come back.
FM Talk 106.5, the Gulf Coast Weather Authority. Step up to the firing line. Armed Alabama is back. Questions, comments, and texts at 343-0106.
I need your clothes, your boots, and your motorcycle. You forgot to say please.
All right, this is Armed Alabama. We're back. Glad you could join us. I'm glad you could hang with us tonight. 2 hour show here. We're 30 minutes into our 2 hour show from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. And again, we're very glad you could join us. Just before the break, we were talking about the attack that took place in Istanbul, Turkey at the nightclub. There were 70 wounded, 39 was killed, and the victims, Matt, which I thought was interesting, were from 14 different countries. So that's pretty significant, and one nightclub. And we were discussing whether or not the attacker was actually a part of ISIS. ISIS has a claim responsibility, but that determination, I think, has yet to be made as of this point, at least with what I read today. I stated earlier that the attacker looked like that he had some training just by the way he moved, mm-hmm. the way he was sliced a pie on the video that I had seen. Trying to lean it. Actually, he was, when I say slicing the pie, he just kind of leaning in to the doorway there to try to engage. I think at that point, we're engaging the security guard. He engaged a police officer, I think, right out front. So it was, I didn't get a chance to see. I just only seen the video that's been released. There are some more video from what I read that has not been released that investigators and authorities are looking at. I think that they had identified a possible suspect today, but I think that he was picked up, interviewed, and he was released. So now the attacker is still pretty much still on the loose. And there are, at this time, those 16 people that are being held for questioning. So,
interesting.
It's kind of tough. I mean, people are there New Year's Eve, there to celebrate. And one report that I had read stated that this it was a club, but it stated that everybody was there were Christians, and I'm not sure if I wasn't able to verify that, but it was supposedly a Christian party mm-hmm. at this club, but I'm not sure. I couldn't verify it in another news outlet, but it's something that we all have to kind of be vigilant of this age and this day and age, because that's happened here
in
the United States. Yeah,
absolutely.
In Orlando, Florida. So those type of attacks can happen anywhere in the world.
University of Texas.
Yes.
School tower there.
So it's just you have to be on your guard, it seems like, when you walk out of your house. And even in your house, you have to be on guard. As with over the weekend, there was a home invasion Friday night. And also an officer involved shooting in Pensacola that left one man dead and another in the hospital. Around 1 a.m., an intruder broke into a Pensacola home, shot the homeowner three times and their dog. And by the time the perpetrator got out of the house, police had arrived on the scene. And, of course, he shot at police officers when they arrived, and police returned fire, shooting the assailant, or the intruder. So you can't even be safe in your own home anymore. With that stated, Judge and I, we talk about home hearting. We talk about just easy and simple things that you can do around your home. One of the things that shocked me most with the judge saying is some of the rapes and things that he tried, home invasions, where they came, the perpetrator came in through an unlocked door or window.
And motor vehicle thefts and breaking and entering motor vehicle cases lacks property enforcement. It's kind of the low hanging fruit for the criminal element.
It is. And so if you it's your home, if you're there, regardless of it's night or day, you always want to have your doors and windows locked.
And make sure that you remove your key when you open that front door. I got to admit, I've maybe done that once or twice. But yes, you get distracted, you're carrying your groceries in, the phone rings, and all these distractions, and all of a sudden you wake up the next morning, you can't find your keys. You
left them in your car.
Left them in your car door, or left them in your car, or left them in your front door.
So
the criminals that...
If you have question about your locks, buying good, sturdy locks mm-hmm. would be doorknobs and locks, or deadbolts. Those are things that can be easily done and changed out. It's not going to stop somebody that wants to get in your home, but it will give you time as the homeowner to be able to react.
Yeah.
If somebody's trying to break into your home. Also, and this was a big one for me, is having firearms, different firearms, in multiple locations within your home, within your bedroom, and within the living spaces where you spend most of your time.
Mm-hmm.
And those are things, those are good things. There's been numerous reports I've read over the years where home invasions have taken place, and the homeowner was able to readily get to a firearm that they had over the top of the refrigerator or freezer or something like that, or within the lounge chair pocket. So those are things that you want to look at to have. Is if you have multiple firearms, then be able to, and then have those in multiple locations within your home, because you're not always in the bedroom.
Let me ask you, there are a lot of folks out there like myself who have young children, and I know that's obviously a concern with a gun in the house. What type of measures do you recommend that a homeowner and a parent of a young child take to not only to balance the security issue with the safety issue?
Right, that's a good question, and that is that's a question I get quite often, Matt. Thank you for asking that. I had mentioned keeping on top of a refrigerator or freezer, you know, so if your child is, you know, outside being Spider-Man or Spider-Girl, you know, that's a good location.
Sure.
You know, a lot of, for me, in my home, that's a good location. I also recommend keeping your firearms within a lock box. There's all kind of
I saw something at Sam's, and I think it was over the Christmas. It was like a palm reader,
yes,
or fingerprint?
Yeah. Well, there's several different ones. They have a code that you can quickly put in, or they actually have a biometric lock
that's
where they actually reads your palm print or your fingerprints and opens. And when it opens, it's spring loaded, so it just pops right open, and you can get it open within a second or two. Mm-hmm. It doesn't take long at all. And again, it is spring loaded, so that way you're not fiddling with the front of the door, mm-hmm, trying to get it open or manipulating it in a what would be maybe a stressful situation for you, and you get adrenaline pumping, you know, somebody trying to bang into your door, and you're here, you're trying to fiddle with a box, a lock box or something like that. So those boxes that have that biometric lock or some type of little quick code that you can put in. I have one with actually has a little code that you just kind of punch into it real quick. Within 2 seconds, you're in that box.
Yeah, you've got to figure you're going to be disoriented because you're going to be just waking up or going to sleep.
Right.
It's going to be dark. There's going to be a lot of stress and adrenaline pumping.
Sure.
Probably kids, dogs, other distractions, and you got to react quick but safely.
Exactly. And there's lots of different things out on the market. I've seen picture frames where the picture will actually it has a door on the picture frame with you pull the picture frame itself, and in behind it is a holder for a pistol and a magazine. I mean, there's lots of little gizmos or gadgets like that that are specialized, of course. But, you know, just having the firearm out of reach with child is the best thing. And in your bedroom, especially for an older child, you know, we think about child as a toddler.
Yeah.
But maybe older is 5, 6, 7, 8, you know, 10, 12 years old, that you want to be able to keep that firearm.
Yeah, and you got to be careful too if your partner's a concealed carry in bed.
Absolutely. So those are things we had mentioned. Like I say, keeping your doors and windows locked at all times, having a sturdy lock, a deadbolt on your entry doors.
And a plan, right? A plan.
And a plan. You know, that's one of the things the judge and I talked about during the classes that we have, that we give, is having a plan. You know, there's a big push several years ago to have a plan in case of a fire.
And
you
sure.
You know, so be able to egress from the residence. So you want to have a plan in place for in case a bad guy comes into your home or tries to come into your home. So those are all things that you have to think about.
Especially if you're a public figure, for instance, you've made some decisions or rulings or represented someone or a cause or an issue that's unpopular, whether it be in whatever line or field you always got to keep that in mind.
Yeah, and a lot of people say, well, I don't want to live in that kind of world, or I don't want to think about that stuff. That sounds kind of paranoid. But in this world, you have insurance. Everyone has insurance on their home or their automobile. So you do that just in case of a fire or just in case of a storm or an accident with your car. So these are just extra measures that you take to ensure your safety and as well as safety of a family member, whether you're a concealed carry or you're setting up, like you said, having a home protection plan.
And I'll just say, if you're in the county, you know, the response time from a deputy sheriff is significantly lower than it would be if you're in the city. So if you're in a more rural area, I mean, in some instances, it could take 45 minutes to an hour to get to the north part of the county. When Judge Johnston always used to tell us, when seconds count, the police are only minutes away. The cases like that have been litigated. Law enforcement has no duty to protect you. There's no constitutional or statutory duty. I mean, they can help, but ultimately it's you.
So we talked about some quick, easy things inside a home. So here's some things outside a home. Look around as you leave your vehicle. You're going to the store or going from the store back to your vehicle. Make sure you park your car in well-lit areas. If you're a little worried about, being out by yourself, go with friends and go with family.
Minimize your selfies and checking in at places and get your head out of your phone.
That's the biggest thing. I couldn't tell how many times I've been shopping.
All been there.
Yeah. Well, I have to look up from my phone to see somebody else on their phone,
Oh, you're texting your next treatise.
Yeah. But, carry on your persons, not in your purse. A lot of women ask me, it's like, well, what's the best way to carry? Can I carry my purse? Do that at your own peril, I think. If you're going to carry your firearm, carry it on your persons in a holster and be proficient with it. All right, we'll have this and more when we come back. This is Armed Alabama. All right, welcome back to Armed Alabama. Glad you could join us tonight. If you have any questions regarding any kind of Christmas presents that you might have had under the tree or something that Santa Claus had brought you, and you got questions about a new firearm or a gear related to firearm or range shooting, or if you just have some new ammunition that you have any questions about, be sure to give us a call at 251-343-0106. We'll be glad to answer them. Speaking of phone calls, we have on the line, Lonnie's calling in from Loosedale. What you got, Lonnie? Hey, glad you could join us.
Is that Mr. Green, before I ask my question, was he a prosecutor in Baldwin County?
Persecutor, I think, would be the more appropriate moniker.
I think he prosecuted my ex-wife. Thank goodness. Now, let me ask you a question. You've been talking about all this crime rate stuff. This Black Lives Matter says if we just pay them restitution for being slaves back then, that all this stuff will stop. What do y'all think of that?
Well, we probably should hope that Loosedale would adopt the 13th Amendment and the 14th Amendment. That would be the first order of business.
What do you think about these chemtrails? Do you think they're causing any of it?
There is a link, according to the Center for Disease Control, between male pattern baldness and these chemtrails. But
y'all are such fools. I had you going. I told you I was going to check in tonight.
Are you live on location, Judge?
I'm calling you through Skype, and I have my Skype phone number, so you wouldn't detect that.
How old is she?
What's that? Y'all were floundering a little, so you needed something to laugh it up.
Thanks for the laughing it up. Thanks, Lonnie.
Yeah,
Black
no doubt.
Lives Matter group issued a list of demands during the summer, and one of them was end to mass incarceration. That's what they call locking people up who have committed crimes. Mass incarceration.
Yeah, you were a contributor to that, huh?
Yeah, I did a lot to contribute to it, and I'm proud of it. And the more people locked in the penitentiary, the safer we are. But now they want to. Now that's a bad word.
That are guilty, of course.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And then the other was this restitution, and of course that takes. That's just a crazy thing because there were, although it was a small number, there were free blacks who actually owned slaves. And so what do you do about that? I can't imagine. But they have already started harassing some of the New England insurance companies or the successors to them and successor banks to New York banks that financed slaves and issued insurance policy on slaves, because slavery couldn't have existed without those financial institutions financing and insuring and all. So they're serious, and they say the cause of crime is not what everybody thinks. It is pure out racism on the part of the white majority. Now, we know this doesn't make a lot of sense, but that's what they say it is. And so I assume if we meet all their demands, then the crime will go away. So it probably would be cheaper to meet all their demands, and then the crime will stop. Of course, people will still kill their wives in a fit of jealousy and all those kind of things, which, you know, is a lot of crime out there. Passion crime, I guess. But you mentioned a real
that might be account
point
for the 762 murders in Chicago. You think is crimes of passion?
Passionate people.
You know, I started thinking, is that necessarily a bad thing? When, I mean, there's some, you know, Matt mentioned, and I mentioned somebody else, about 90%, 75% or more, it's closer to 90, of people who are killed are people who are involved in some kind of bad act at the time. They got the wrong end on a drug deal, or, you know, they were involved in something criminal. Now, you have totally innocent people like the young black girl a few weeks ago, but that is just kind of rare. Most of the time, you know, it's some man out looking for a hooker, and then he gets killed by her John. You know, it's that kind of thing. So I don't know that 700 people in Chicago dying is necessarily a bad thing. For the innocent people, it is. But for the people who were getting ready to kill somebody else and somebody got them first, I don't know that it really is a bad thing.
Well, as a former prosecutor, I think it's bad. I'd go after him.
Good for you. Good for you. You're taking that oath seriously. Well, we're turning into, you know, if you actually look at it through the ages, this is a historically safe time to live. We don't have hordes from Mongolia sweeping into the villages, capturing our women and cattle and taking them off. I mean, it really, really is. But, you know, we model everything on the 50s when it was really safe. And compared to the 50s, it's not as safe as it was. It's safer than it was in the 70s, actually, with the crime rate. But, you know, we've got, the reason we have a lot of crime is we have too many laws. And the more laws you enact, the more crime you're going to have. We've got a lot of silly laws on the books that we need to take a look at that are unenforceable. And yet, the police, if you talk to them, they'll tell you that. We've got to think about, you know what I mean?
Executive agencies issuing regulations that carry the a sentence of incarceration that require no criminal intent.
I say strict liability of offenses. Absolutely right. You know, people hauled off because they didn't meet a building code or a land use violation. You know, they're put in the penitentiary, or the famous one of the frozen shrimp that weren't furnished.
Oh, yeah,
the
Honduran case that Quinn Hillier wrote about.
Yep. So, you know, we got to think about
the Honduran lobster. They were packaged in the wrong containers, in violation of Honduran law, which turns out it was not a violation of Honduran law.
Right. I mean, that's the federal court system needs to be dialed back to 1789 before they passed the Judiciary Act, because they're the source of a lot of the problem, just like was predicted by Brutus and the Anti-Federalist Papers. They have grown and grown and grown and grown and become the most powerful branch of government.
And least accountable.
It has been, you know, they rarely declare laws passed by Congress unconstitutional. Rarely.
Yeah, it's like double deference that Randy Barnett speaks of.
Yeah,
Yeah, and you know, Clark Neely talked about that.
The Institute
they
for Justice.
They frequently declare laws passed by legislatures unconstitutional.
And you're right, and you know who really is adversely affected, the most at-risk category of people, the poor and minorities.
Absolutely, because the people closest to us in the hometowns, we know what's best, and we pass those laws. And they specifically talked about giving at least Congress what they called the negative, so Congress could negate any state laws, and the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia rejected that. They didn't want anything to do with that, and yet we basically have that right now. But y'all are coming in loud and clear and doing a good job, so I'll get out of the way in case any legitimate callers want to call in.
Well, your call was legitimate. We appreciate you calling, Judge.
Yeah, I had to. I actually was going to ask him a really complicated one, but
I think that'd be good.
I decided not to.
Looks like you popped up on the no-fly list now with this recent call.
Yeah, I probably have. I've been on there a while, I'm afraid. Y'all keep it up. We'll talk to you later.
All right, thank you, Judge. Appreciate it. Hi, if you have any questions that you want to call and ask about, especially about any type of firearm or a gift that you got during the holidays, give us a call.
FM Talk 106.5, the Gulf Coast Weather Authority. The safety is off. There's a round in the chamber. This is Armed Alabama, sponsored by Corey Outdoor Company, Mobile's hometown full-line outdoor sporting products and gear store, an interactive talk show discussing self-defense, product reviews, shooting tips, safety, and more. Your calls, comments, and texts welcome at 343-0106. Now, here are your hosts, retired judge and certified NRA instructor, Rusty Johnston, and certified NRA law enforcement instructor, Adam Strange.
They're gonna pry these guns right out. Tired of your cry, it's gonna rain wrath, beware. Don't tread on me, I'm American free. Not gonna take it away. I stand up and fight for my freedoms and rights. That's a price you'll have to pay. Don't tread on me, I'm American free. Red-blooded to the core. You ain't ever had a fight in your life like a fight.
Welcome back to Armed Alabama. This is Matt Green sitting in for Judge Rusty Johnston. I'm joined by Adam Strange here tonight. Call us here tonight at 343-0106 if you have any questions or want to talk about any firearm-related issues. Adam, I don't know if you've seen this reported, but there's a talk on Capitol Hill that the Trump administration may be pushing a nationwide firearm reciprocity bill. Interesting and he apparently may have the votes to get this passed. It's come up short several times, this legislation has, but particularly some states that aren't very that have state or local laws that aren't very firearm friendly will now could possibly be subject to federal legislation that would basically require states to recognize other states' firearm laws, provided that they were indeed passed constitutional muster. That's a kind of a double-edged sword for some people and for some conservatives that are generally against a vast expanse of federal power. But
I would agree. I think that should be left to the states. I think maybe if anything, it should be pushed on some of the states. When I say pushed, maybe states invited to adopt other states' concealed carry permits.
Through incentives instead of federal legislation?
Absolutely, absolutely. And to target those attorney generals of those states, because ultimately that's where that power relies, or the state legislatures to say, okay, you're going to, and these states are be like Nevada, California, South Carolina, and New Mexico are the ones that really kind of think, and Illinois, of course, have issue. And this, not a state at all, but the District of Columbia. Mm-hmm. So these are the ones that are say are problem child, if you will, but I don't think the federal government should be mulling in this.
And I would tend to agree with you. I think that many gun rights activists are maybe blinded by this single issue, that whatever it takes to get it done. But I think, as we've seen from the prior administration of either a vast expanse, prior several, like last 175 years,
yes,
the vast expanse of the federal government into the everyday lives of Americans have you know, posed problems to liberty lovers. You wonder, what is the segue? What gives the federal government? Where would their end be? How would they regulate? What mechanism by which are they authorized to pass this act? And many people say that they'll use the old Commerce Clause, which is the old whipping boy of traditional progressives, that which has ushered in a vast amount of federal regulations and host of federal law into the
including
the expense of state
Obamacare,
and you know, as you remember, the Obama administration, that was one of the major thrust or arguments that they had for the Affordable Care Act, that it was a power that Congress was authorized to pass in response to or because of the Commerce Clause. Fortunately, the court struck that down, and Justice Roberts saved it as a tax, which. But the issue of the vast expanse of the Commerce Clause, because for a while there, it looked like there were really no limiting principles on the Commerce Clause, and that's that really dates back to the Wickard and Filburn case during the FDR era, and the progressives who ushered in a host of federal regulations at the expense of state and local government and the liberty of individuals to freely contract, and it's just been problematic on many levels. But the concern is there. If you allow them, the federal government, to you authorize them to do that, what's to say that a subsequent administration was to pass a nationwide gun registry program,
right,
under the same precedent, under federal power?
I think what you said, they're setting a precedence there, and I think that's something that we don't need to set. I think for most people at first blush, when they hear Trump saying, okay, well, we're going to make a nationwide requirement, that every state recognize another state's firearm permit or concealed carry permit, that sounds good. But you have to go past that. You have to look past that. And as you stated, with that precedence, it can be a slippery slope.
But I would be interested to hear some of the callers, if they are have similar concerns, or their concerns are if they want to travel to New York and they leave their lawfully registered firearm, they have a pistol permit in Alabama, and they have it in their car, and they get pulled over by a New York State trooper, or they carry it to a monument or have it in one of their fanny packs, so they're prosecuted for a felony gun crime. I can see the concern there as well, but you know, I think that the courts may recognize now that through the 14th Amendment, that may be the better way to challenge it than through nationwide a federal mandate.
Right. Well, at one time, man, you couldn't have your firearm on a if you went to a national park or something, mm-hmm, like that, you couldn't have your firearm there. Now you can. So those are the kind of things.
Rest areas, another area in Alabama, for instance.
Right. And that's something that's only recently has been changed, where you can have your firearm at a rest area. And to me, in my mind, late at night, stopping at a rest area with the freaks and geeks that can be there, that would seem to me would be a logical place where you want to have your firearm to be a concealed carry holder. In an environment like that.
You're reminiscent, was it that something about Mary scene when they stopped at the rest area and it was dark and they hit the headlights and all the people engaged in nefarious conduct were visible? So I can understand your concern about the rest areas being an area of concern. I think nowadays you're going to start to see, in terms of litigation, college campuses and universities being
the
sources,
hot button,
that type of litigation of Second Amendment rights. You know, the Clery Act is a federal act that requires universities to disclose, in theory, they're supposed to disclose certain violent crimes, and some of it's been watered down. But if you start looking at the numbers, universities, if you're disarmed, you become a very vulnerable individual. And the university police are sometimes not equipped. And you've seen some of the issues with some our local university police. They've had some problems with issues with crime and firearms.
I think a crime at any major city will happen at any major university. And those officers have to be able to be equipped for that, whether it be training or with gear.
All right, Tony from Daphne. You're on the air.
Hey, good evening, guys.
How you doing this evening? Thanks for joining us.
Oh, thank you. I know Matt and I go back a long way. He's prosecuted a lot of cases that my peers and I have made over the years, and he's always been a law and order judge, law and order prosecutor. I was glad to see him on the show tonight.
Thank you, Tony. Tony is one of our outstanding members of the Bowen County Sheriff's Office. He and I prosecuted several sex offenders, property crimes, murders, you name it. Tony was with the Criminal Investigations Division, and Tony is real active in the community, and he's just an outstanding member of law enforcement, and I'm so excited to have you on the air tonight. Thanks for calling.
Absolutely. Well, I guess, you know, not to take you away from your topic on carry, because I could certainly speak on some opinions on that, I guess. But with the new administration coming in and Jeff Sessions as the hopeful new attorney general, I'm hoping to see a real swing back towards law and order in our federal prosecution and our federal court system. I remember back in the day, and it would have been back in the days when you and I were probably at our peak, of prosecuting cases, there really being a lot of federal firearms prosecutions. There was the Project Safe Streets or Project Safe Neighborhoods. There was a lot of federal money being placed into task force officers, local officers being attached to the ATL that were making tons and tons of firearms cases. And when I talk about firearms cases, I'm not talking about, good guys with guns in bad circumstances. I'm talking about criminals that were armed while they were committing their crimes.
Violent offenses.
Yeah. Hey, Tony, we've got to go to a break. Can you hang on until after the break? We definitely want to hear what you got to say.
It's good stuff.
All right, we'll be back with this and more on Armed Alabama. Just hang with us, Tony.
Don't get caught in the dark when the lights go out.
Generators to keep you out of the dark. Grayson Air Conditioning repairs most other generator brands and offers service agreements to keep your generator ready when power is lost. With this agreement, you can leave home when a storm is coming. Like Grayson AC on Facebook, on the web at graysonairconditioning.com, or stop by their offices at 7200 Regions Bank, or call 633-5665 for service. This program is a production of Armed Alabama, LLC. The comments and views of the hosts are those of Armed Alabama, LLC, for which it is solely responsible. The view and comments of the callers, guests, and texters do not necessarily represent the views of the sponsors or advertisers of Armed Alabama, LLC, or of Armed Alabama, LLC, Bigler Broadcasting, LLC, FM Talk 106.5, or WAB. Judge Johnston should be taken as legal advice, but as educational information. Judge Johnston is not engaged in the practice of law and should not be sought out to answer legal questions off the air. Seek legal advice from a qualified attorney who knows the complete specifics of your legal matter. When buying a vehicle, don't waste your valuable time. David Harnell at Palmer's Toyota is committed to getting you the best deal on a new, used, or leased car. And David will do that without wasting your time. Play the with game. See David Parnell today. Palmer's Toyota, 470 Schillinger Road South. That's David Parnell at Palmer's Toyota, 639-0800, extension 168. Don't forget to see David Parnell at Palmer's Toyota, Schillinger Road, just south of airport. He won't waste your time.
Step up to the firing line. Armed Alabama is back. Questions, comments, and texts at 343-0106.
One minute, Ned, or see you hanged in Fort Smith at Judge Parker's convenience. Which will it be? I call that bold talk for a one-eyed fat man.
Welcome back to Armed Alabama. This is Matt Green. I'm filling in for Judge Rusty Johnston. I'm joined by Adam Strange. We're here with caller Tony. Welcome, Tony, you still with us?
I am, yes.
Yeah, I was talking with you during the break, and yeah, I have noticed... it seems to be less in the U.S. Attorney's Office, and less drug prosecutions, less firearm prosecutions, and you'll see you're starting to see more crimes like marriage, the fraudulent marriage. You remember the fraudulent marriage cases they spent a long time prosecuting here in the Southern District? There were several high-profile cases. This U.S. Attorney's Office seems to be more about rehabilitation and with drug-related offenses. And I think, you know, they get their marching orders from Washington and the Justice Department. I think I can certainly see that.
I guess, you know, my point was is that, in my opinion and in my experience, we were seeing a real positive impact on armed criminality, on people using guns in the commission of their crimes. I mean, it was just real. It was tangible. We would arrest someone for burglary, say, and they possessed a weapon while they were committing the burglary. That added that federal charge. And, I mean, I can remember dozens of guys, literally, I mean, you know, criminals, crying when we told them that the ATF was going to pick up their case. And there were just huge numbers of gun prosecutions all over the country, and that's just gone down dramatically. And when I say dramatically, I mean dramatically in the last 8 years. And it's all been driven by this administration, and it's a shame. They talk about passing new gun laws. We don't need that. We need strict federal prosecutions that result in real day-for-day jail time. And in my opinion, as long as we have more federal drug prosecutions than we have federal gun prosecutions, then we're really just we're missing...
spinning our wheels.
We're missing the point here. So I guess my question is, do you think that may be a priority of Jeff Sessions?
Yes,
the upcoming administration, if
I do,
he is, in fact, our Attorney General.
I think you're exactly right, and I think that's what's frightening to many people, and I think that's why you're going to see a pretty significant fight. I think the Republicans will have the votes, but I think it will be a fight for Senator Sessions. But I think there are many people in this country, and I don't like speaking for many people, but I have this feeling, from what I've seen, that Jeff Sessions will present a return to law and order in this in the new administration. I think he's probably one of the most well-respected members of the Senate who has gravitas and is respected on both sides of the aisle. And I think that with his experience as an attorney general of the state of Alabama and at the state level, which I think is a significant, he hadn't spent his whole time a career in federal in the federal government. He spent it, you know, significantly the burdens and realizations and problems and unique situations posed by federalism that state AGs face. And I think he will present a return to law and order that this country really has been lacking for the last 8 years. I think you make a very salient point.
Well, I just certainly hope that we see just real adamant prosecution of what's on the books, because I do believe that that's the root of our problem. If we're talking about gun crime, then how can we be ignoring criminals with guns? And that's what we're doing.
Let me ask you one more question. Based on what you've seen, And my experience here in Mobile, that, and I've talked to several people in law enforcement, that they are certainly seeing some of the effect of the Ferguson effects, where this, and particularly members of our local leadership community, have created this environment that law enforcement is to be distrusted, and that law enforcement now is under policing in some instances. Are you seeing any of that in Baldwin County?
Well, I can say, and again, I speak just as an individual officer.
Sure.
I certainly don't represent my agency or anything in this, but I can tell you that, in my opinion, the answer to that is maybe the tiniest bit, but largely no. And I think it just has a lot to do with where we are. The fact that we do feel like we have the support of the vast majority of the people in our county and in surrounding counties, even, that the vast majority of the people are pro-law enforcement. Now, you know, has it taken a little bit of the wind out of the sails from our probably some of our young guys and the old guys? Absolutely. Has it had a negative impact on our recruiting? Absolutely. We're recovering from that, trying to. But I'm happy to say I think the rank and file are still out there doing their job. But again, that largely has to do with the area that we're in.
It helps, I think, that y'all have...
It's true in these other areas.
By and large, it appears to me that the leadership among local and county government officials over there seems to be much more supportive of law enforcement over there than in some have exhibited here.
No, I agree with that, absolutely. I mean, you know, I think the vast majority of the police chiefs over here, the sheriff over here, I mean, they're law and order guys. Generally, I would say that their philosophies are pretty darn close to the philosophies of their men. And that means that they're mission-oriented and they're just there to do the job.
Sure.
And when you have that kind of environment, you know, you don't dissuade proactivity, you don't dissuade productivity, and in fact, those types of, you know, that type of activity is rewarded. So,
why is it you think that, why do you think you got involved? Why did you get involved in law enforcement? And why do you, what would you recommend to someone else today to get involved in law enforcement?
Well, Matt, the reason I got in law enforcement is I thought about being a lawyer, and I didn't want to major in political science, so I majored in criminal justice. And I did a summer with Pensacola PD, and I was around a lot of cops and a lot of lawyers. And sorry, buddy, but I decided to go with law enforcement. I kind of got the bug and never looked back. So that's how I ended up in law enforcement. But you know, what would I tell a young guy now is to follow it. If you're drawn to it, guy or girl, and we've got some amazing female deputies in Baldwin County and police officers in Baldwin County, and real proud of those girls. But I think if you think that's your calling, then you need to get out here and find out if that's for you. You're one of two things is going to happen. You're going to realize that it's not for you, and you're going to get out of law enforcement pretty quickly. Or you're going to realize that this was your calling and that you'll do it for the rest of your life. You may end up questioning it later in life, but you'll do it for the rest of your life because nothing else will satisfy you.
That's outstanding.
Good insight, Tony. Thank you so much for calling.
Call back, please. It's one of the better calls we've had.
Well, y'all, thanks again for having me, and have a good show. Thank you.
Be safe.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it. All right, next caller we have is Greg's calling in from Mobile, and he has a question regarding a Christmas gift.
Yes.
What you got, Greg?
You're cutting out.
You're cutting out. Go ahead. What you got?
I'm sorry. I just purchased a handgun during the holidays.
Yes,
from
sir.
A major chain. I was just wondering, is that considered a registered handgun just by purchasing and buying it and leaving the store with it?
No, it is not.
Okay.
No, it is not. So that's kind of a misnomer to go and or have to register your firearm, or when you purchase your firearm, it's registered. That does not take place.
But apparently, you had to be vetted through the naughty or nice list. So
yeah.
You're on some government or Santa list. So just be careful
right.
Out there.
Yeah, I was able to get it. So it was some kind of list.
And I'm sure it crossed state lines when Santa brought it in. So it's probably involved in interstate commerce. So I'm sure you've implicated several federal acts.
Yeah, it was a straw purchase.
Oh, okay. A straw purchase, my goodness. Yeah, I'm sure we can think of about five or six federal firearm violations.
Absolutely.
If you give us some time.
Oh, okay. Well, that's good to know.
I didn't call.
Well,
you didn't call.
We just imagined.
You can trust us, Greg. I'm a lawyer.
Okay.
Well, Merry Christmas.
Yeah, thank you for calling
Happy
in.
Happy New Year.
It was good that you could get a firearm for Christmas. As the judge says, it's not Christmas unless a firearm is under the tree. So
now, why aren't you registered, though? There's a record of the sale.
The record of the sale only is retained by the gun shop or whatever. Yes, they had to require to call in with that purchase to Nixus, and you're run against that database.
And where does the serial number of the gun go?
That's a good question. It'll probably be listed.
Is it part of the sale transaction?
Sure. The ATF can run a firearms trace on it, and they could find out. They could go to the purchaser. They could trace it from
there. They have to go to the purchaser to where the firearm was purchased at.
Okay, so when our gun
is
registered.
But that is not, once that firearm is purchased, that the information is supposed to be disregarded after a certain length of time, and I can't remember exactly what that time is.
So our guns not ever registered then?
No. They're not, supposedly.
Well, that's a surprising answer to me.
If the law works as it should be not. Now, if they want to know who purchased a certain firearm, they have to go to the place where the firearm was purchased.
Looks like Greg jettisoned the call already.
He was gone.
Yeah, he was gone.
So, that's a good question, and a lot of people don't realize that.
So, Adam, I'm going to do like Johnny Carson used to do the flash card on top of your head. 103. You know what 103 is? 103 is the number of federal judiciary positions that President-elect Donald Trump could fill. You know how many President Obama inherited when 8 years ago when he assumed the presidency?
No, I don't know.
54.
That he kept on? Is that what you're saying?
I'm just saying that
he kept on.
He can appoint 103 lower federal court judges.
Okay.
That's where a vast majority of our federal firearm cases are going to be decided in the lower federal court system.
So Trump really not only what's everybody been talking about has been Supreme Court justice. How many potential Supreme Court justices could he appoint? And which is important.
Sure.
But what really is important is the 103.
Exactly, because most of those cases do not get appealed, and the Supreme Court grants a review or what they call certiorari in a tiny minority of the cases. So when you're talking about 103 court vacancies, that is a significant public policy avenue or vehicle for him to enact appoint judges that could be firearm friendly.
So that's new information to me.
So you're not talking about gun laws, abortion, free speech, right, health care, occupational licensing, all these host of constitutional rights.
Step up to the firing line. Armed Alabama is back. Questions, comments, and texts at 343-0106.
The 45 long slide with laser sighting.
These are brand new. We just got them in. That's a good gun. Just touch the trigger, the beam comes on, and you put the red dot where you want the bullet to go. You can't miss. Anything else?
Phased plasma rifle in the 40-watt range.
Hey, guess what you see, pal?
The Uzi 9mm.
You know your weapons, buddy. Any one of these is ideal for home defense. So, what shall it be?
All.
I'm gonna close early today. There's a 15-day wait on the handguns and rifles you can take right now. You can't do that.
Wrong.
Welcome back to Armed Alabama. This is Matt Green. I'm sitting in for Judge Rusty Johnston. I'm joined by Adam Strange. Adam, tell me, we kind of left off a second ago, that a lot of people seem fixated, a lot of the pundits, with the potential Supreme Court vacancy, or not the potential, the Supreme Court vacancy that's open right now. But right now, there are 103 lower court vacancies that are yet to be filled that President Trump will presumably make nominees for. And most of the public policy involving the Constitution or federal laws are determined at the lower court or lower appellate court, what they call the Court of Appeals,
right,
the 11 circuits in the United States. They're decided there. But I was doing some research tonight. There are 103 vacancies. That's nearly twice the amount President Obama had when he first assumed the presidency 8 years ago. And a lot of people just don't realize that.
And that's a good point, because I really didn't realize that when you brought it up a while ago, and that's shocking. And that Trump has the potential over the next 4 years in appointing these judges to really set a tone, a conservative tone, I hope,
sure,
for the United States as far as judicial law and the law of the land.
And that scares the heck out of a lot of people, I know, just by reading. And there's some conservatives that are a little bit concerned with some Trump, potential Trump appointments. But from the names that I've seen and the people that he's listening to, people like at Heritage and the Federalist Society, those are good core conservative libertarian people that respect the rule of law and believe in a government of limited and enumerated powers. And those would, you know, potentially... a Mobilian is in the mix. William Pryor, Circuit Judge, Circuit Court of Appeals, 11th Circuit Court of Appeals, Judge William Pryor is a Jeff Sessions protege. He was also, succeeded Senator Sessions from when he was AG. He was an attorney general as well. He's mentioned as probably one of two possible finalists for that position. Judge Dan Sykes and Judge William Pryor, those are the two names that have been mentioned. That would be quite incredible to have a Mobilian as the Attorney General of the United States of America and a Mobilian sitting on the United States Supreme Court. Judge Pryor is very young. He would serve presumably for a significant period of time,
right,
which I think,
right,
when you're talking about a legacy, That's the true legacy of a president, is and where his public policy issues can be enacted is through the judiciary.
That's a good point. Very good point. All right, the phone banks are filling up right now, so we're going to go ahead and go to Mark's calling in from Daphne, or excuse me, it's Mike. Mike has a question on concealed carry.
Okay. I just wanted to know, I was thinking about getting a concealed carry. I called in before and talked about, you know, permits, but the thing about it is I've been wondering and tossing around in my head the idea. I don't know whether I ought to get a revolver. I feel safer, like more reliable with a revolver. You know, they seem more reliable to me. I've shot both automatics and revolvers that other people owned.
Yeah, I think that's a good question, Mike. From a functionality standpoint, there's lots of advantages to revolvers, and for some people, there's advantages, disadvantages, and that's why people like maybe a pistol itself, which is what I carry is a pistol, because just for the sheer fact that there's a lot more ammunition in a magazine versus a revolver, if it's five or six, right. Or some revolvers even carry seven or even more.
Mike, excuse me, I'm with you. I have a revolver, I have a 38, and I'm with you. I feel more comfortable with one, and that's the way I'm right there with you.
So it's like a computer mouse, it's point and click.
I really like
old
revolver.
Trusty.
You know, it's more reliable, but dadgum, I talked to a law enforcement officer in Pascagoula a while back, and he said if it was him, he would go for a high capacity.
Well, you're going to get different variations of opinion, and that's what we always say, is you got to get something that you're comfortable with, and you feel
more comfortable with a revolver, then I think
you've answered your question. So appreciate the phone call, Mike.
Good question, Mike.
It was a good question.
I got one more question, please.
Yes, sir.
All right, quickly.
Okay. What caliber is the least caliber do you think would be a reliable caliber to use for self-defense?
22.
Oh, really? That
yeah.
Low?
Yeah, absolutely.
He didn't even hesitate.
No. 22, I mean, gets such a bashing, I think, from people, but 22 is very reliable in a revolver, and it's a very deadly round. Very, very deadly.
Ronald Reagan was shot with a 22.
Yeah, more people have been killed with a 22 than...
Goodness.
Than, yeah.
So than, you mean like an LCR that holds 8 rounds wouldn't be a bad choice?
No. Not when it comes to 22. Thank you, Mike. Appreciate your phone call.
I enjoy your show.
Thank you so much. All right, next caller is Mark calling in from Daphne, if I'm getting the right one here. Yeah, Mark.
Yeah, this is Mark. First time caller, guys. I was driving in. I heard your show for the first time, and just want to give you a call.
Thank you.
Hey, you're more than welcome. I appreciate what you guys are doing. I'm a relatively new concealed carry permit holder. And I've noticed that a lot of the storefronts have the signs that say no firearms allowed. Some of them are so small, you don't notice them at first. And I was just wondering, what's the procedure? What should I be doing when I encounter one of those signs?
That's a good question, Mark. And, you know, they're really supposed to be visible from 25 feet away. again, some of them aren't that way, but I think that might be a good question for Matt.
Well, yeah, if they have that sign up, for it really to be enforceable, they're required to have some type of security to provide for you. And I've encouraged people that if someone's injured or of a victim of a violent crime and they own a business that has a sign like that, and they're because of the sign, they're encouraged not to carry it. They become targets. And if they don't provide adequate security, I think a civil cause of action may exist against that business for failing to. They have a duty to protect and to provide for the safety of their patrons. And if they have rules or regulations that they ask you to abide by, and you do that, and as a result you're harmed, I think you have a civil cause of action against them. Now, as they do have the right to, as a business owner, they can make you leave the property. If you refuse, or you get in a fight, or they can obviously arrest you for disorderly conduct or something like that, and they have the right to do that. But generally, where you see these rules and regulations strictly scrutinized is when it's a government entity or property, because then it's official government action, which triggers constitutional protections, whereas generally private action does not.
Okay.
Is that a somewhat answer?
Well, yeah, somewhat answer the question, I think, without it. I know we went to a well-known establishment over the holidays to see Christmas lights, and they had one of the signs that I noticed there was a couple of deputies there. Then I noticed the sign, and then I took my weapon back to the car and locked it in the trunk. So.
Well, that was a responsible thing to do, and right. But, yeah, I think it may take somebody getting hurt and filing a civil lawsuit and potentially obtaining a large, and I'm not trying to encourage people to be too happy, but, you know, if you have a constitutional right and you try to exercise it and any party tries to infringe upon that and you suffer injury as a result, then you're well within your rights.
Yeah, and those signs carry no force of law.
Yeah.
You know, that's something that I think people kind of overlook, but they don't.
Mm-hmm.
And they, like you said, they can ask you to leave.
Yeah, and then if you refuse to leave, they can charge you with criminal trespass. But the mere, you know, like you said, it's not a crime.
Right.
Okay. Right. All right. Well, I mean, like I said, I noticed one the other day, I mean, to be totally honest, I had been in the store, made my purchase, was coming out, and it was hidden. To me, it was hidden in the bottom of the store window, and it was rather small. And then I was like, oh, well, I probably should have done that. But,
well, and Mark, and those, same situation. I've been in a store several times and did not see the sign when I went in there. And as, you know, as I walked out, I've walked back into the store several times and stated I would not have made a purchase. I would have not a patron this business had I known that they restricted, restricted firearms.
Conscientious objector.
Absolutely. And I've also turned around and have called, you know, called the owner or whatever. So those are things that a regular Joe citizen can do. So thank you for your call, Mark.
And one more thing, Mark, you may want to go to social media to expose it and express your concerns. I bet you there are other people out there that if you brought enough pressure to bear that the business proprietor may consider it, changing it.
Okay, it's a very good idea. Guys, thanks for your information.
All right, thank you for your call, Mark. Next caller is Ray's calling in from Mobile. His question is national reciprocity.
How you guys doing?
All right.
Good evening, Ray.
Good deal. Hey, I just wanted to start out by saying that, you know, this is just my personal opinion, but the people that in this country that are, say, anti-gun, that were trying to restrict the rights of law-abiding gun owners are not at all concerned, in my opinion, with gun violence. They just want to restrict your right to own a gun. And what I'm saying is that if they can some way make you a helpless victim, then you fall right into their hands.
Because then they need government protection and become dependent, correct?
Right.
I understand, yeah.
I mean, if the federal government was really concerned about gun violence, they would be on Los Angeles, Chicago, New Orleans, like flies on a cow patty. But they're not. So what I'm saying is all this gun violence in these big cities, it plays right into the anti-gunner's hands.
Well, I think it's a good statement. I just look at the Chicago we talked about earlier tonight with 762 murders for exactly. 2016, and they have the most restrictive gun laws in the United States as far as a municipality.
Right, and they never talk about that until they want to throw the numbers out to restrict law-abiding gun owners' rights. That's when they throw the numbers out of gun violence.
No, you're right. I think there's a significant
inner cities.
There's a significant amount of people in this country that do not believe that rights come from the government and that they don't believe in natural rights, the right natural right that you're born with that our founders incorporated into the Bill of Rights.
That's my point. And the thing about national reciprocity is just my opinion. But I don't think the federal government needs to be involved in national reciprocity.
That's right. That's a good point, Ray. We got to go to a break. We appreciate your call.
Great call, Ray. Thanks.
We'll have more Armed Alabama after this break. All right. Welcome back to Armed Alabama. So glad you could join us. It's the last segment of a two-hour show. 2 hours goes by really fast, doesn't it, here?
Sure does. We get some interesting calls tonight.
And we appreciate you tuning in to Armed Alabama. We want to thank our advertisers and sponsors. Without them, this show would not happen. So David Parnell at Palmer's Toyota, Dr. Justin Foster at Foster Chiropractic of Tumas Corner, David Grayson, of Grayson Heating and Air, McCoy Outdoors, and joining with me tonight, Matt Green is a show sponsor, so we appreciate that. And we appreciate you joining us tonight, Matt.
Thank you. I just got out of wardrobe, and we were excited about being here tonight. I will say this about McCoy Outdoors. I always try to go get my tennis shoes there. There's a guy who works there named Joe Sims. He's been there for a long, long time. You know, it's not like going to one of these other places where you walk around and you don't have any help. And Joe will get you in. He'll try you on shoes. He'll tell you what you need to get. He'll tell you what shoes are. He'll basically fit you and give you a lot of attention. And I went in there right before Thanksgiving and had a real good experience. So I would encourage people to go to McCoy Outdoors if you're a runner or need tennis shoes, especially Joe. Ask for Joe. He's a great guy.
Yeah, a lot of people don't realize the knowledge that McCoy Outdoors, each person at each department, and there's so much of a variety there at McCoy's. It's, like you said, anything from running shoes to hunting gear.
You're not going to be waiting around for a price check or somebody to come.
Walking around the aisles trying to find somebody.
Like
each person there is extremely knowledgeable about the merchandise within their department, whether it's gun sales, bows. They have a guy on staff there that handles the bows that can correct the bow for you, set it up for you, repair it. So McCoy's is a one-stop shop when it comes to sporting goods.
Nothing's more frustrating when you go in. Do you ask for a particular product in their inventory? And I don't know. I'll have to check.
Yeah.
And they wander off and you never see them again.
Right. I took my youngest daughter in there a few months ago to buy a firearm that we could use and she could learn on. And, man, it was just great. They worked with us and had lots of different firearms there. And she handled each one of them to kind of see which one that she liked that we all could use. You know. And so McCoy was great with that. And it was a great experience for her. She was so excited about it.
Oh,
she had such a good time when we were there.
My five-year-old came with me, and Joe actually had his dog, his pet there, and was walking around and let my five-year-old play with it and fit me with some shoes. And everybody walked out with a smile.
Good deal. So be sure and check out McCoy's. They're right off of 65 on
Spring Hill Avenue. It used to be the old K&B back in the old days. It's Enterprise rent a car there.
Yep.
It's right near the interstate.
So they're very, very convenient to go shopping. So check out McCoy Outdoors. All right, I got a couple of callers real quick here. Wiley is calling from Goshen, Mississippi. Glad you can join us. What you got?
I was wondering about the what y'all think about the firearms or the Hearing Protection Act about making silencers basically over the counter. I've heard about that from the Trump administration is thinking about that.
Okay, well, you got one on me because I haven't heard that, but that's something I will definitely check into.
Would that be a executive order that President Trump may sign? Are you talking about congressional legislation that goes through the legislative process?
Go through the legislative process. They're calling it the Hearing Protection Act is what I've been hearing about anyway.
I have not heard that. That would be interesting.
It would. They definitely have to check that out.
Yeah, it'd be cool to be able to buy a silencer over the counter, wouldn't it?
I'm sure law enforcement would really be happy to hear that.
But I heard his son, Donald Jr., is really the one that's pushed it. So, anyway.
That's interesting. We'll have to do some research and maybe...
Next week, maybe.
You can buy a suppressor over the counter, but you have to file your paperwork, tax stamp, $200.
Much would a suppressor cost? What are we talking about?
Oh, they can range greatly in price, but you're talking, $600-$800 on the cheap side, and then you have to factor in the cost of the tax stamp. So that's another, if it's $800 on the cheap side, now you're talking $1,000. And then up.
Mm-hmm.
So they can be quite costly.
Pricey.
But, you definitely make the weapon significantly quieter. It's not going to silence the weapon, but it make it significantly quieter. So last caller is from Mobile. Is Anna, what you got, Anna?
Hey, guys. Hey, y'all night.
Good evening, Anna. Is it Anna or Anna?
Anna.
Okay.
A-N-N-A, Anna.
Maybe that was a Yankee phonetic. I'm sorry.
I'm a gun owner, and I'm, permitted to consider a concealed weapon. And what gets me is when they have a violent crime and involving a firearm, besides trying to find out who else is involved with this homicide or whatever it is, why don't they go after the ones that he bought the guns from, try to find out that? Because you know good and well, 95% of the time, they're illegal. They purchased.
Oh, I guarantee you, in every homicide or violent crime, that's going to be one of the first things that any law enforcement officer is going to do. They're going to do a firearms trace, and they'll probably look at every purchaser or predecessor in interest. I remember I prosecuted a kidnapper over in Baldwin County one time, arrested the defendant, and they asked ATF to help, and ATF did a federal firearms trace, and they had a history of where it was. The defendant actually purchased this legally, but they do that. They just don't. You don't hear about it a lot.
They could actually cut down a lot of, you know, when they have a hard time trying to find a gun to purchase.
Yeah.
If they go after some of these firearm dealers.
I don't know if you heard our Baldwin County deputy call a few minutes ago, but he had mentioned the fact that he's hopeful that the new attorney general and the new the Justice Department under his helm will be more active in enforcing and firearm violations.
Well, and hopefully that it's just Sessions. I think he will.
And that's exactly what I think a lot of people believe he will, and I certainly think he will as well.
But that was my thought, you know.
All right. Thank you so much.
Good
appreciate
point,
you calling
Anna. Thank
in.
You for calling.
Thank you for
thank
listening.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
So I got a text from the judge. She's correcting us already or keeping us straight.
Oh, okay.
So we were talking earlier about the concealed carry permit within different businesses or whatever, where one of the gentlemen called earlier about he went into a private business, a small business where they had, as he went to walk out, he seen the no gun sign. So the judge pointed out that 13A 1152, which I have that right here, it states Alabama authorizes one with a permit to carry on private property, not your own, even a bank, unless specifically named by the law. So you got it too. So you,
I sure did.
Yeah.
So refer to your criminal code or your local family attorney.
Criminal code being in the code of Alabama, 13A 1152, which is if you want to look at Alabama 13A, which we always expiles that.
That's your criminal code, isn't it?
Yeah, it's the criminal code of Alabama, and you can go online and you can look it up. All you got to do is Google code of Alabama, and you can look through there, and it has a table of contents, and you can just pick out what you want to read and read to your heart's content. So there's a lot of information there. If you're really hungry for that and you really want to know it for yourself, instead of having to call it in every week to us, you can find out on your own. So we got 1 minute left. You got anything that you want to close out with, Matt?
I just don't know how we made it without Judge Rusty Johnston and his hyperbole earlier tonight. It certainly salted up the show. It was very, very kind of him to call in. But you have to be diligent in enforcing your rights. If you or your attorney won't do it for you, then they'll steamroll you. So you got to educate yourself. You got to tune into shows like this and stay ever vigilant and. Never dare to assert your rights.
Absolutely. That's a good point. And we talked about that several times on the show.
What is the Alabama state motto? We dare defend our rights.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's up to each of us to defend those rights.
I'm sure that's in violation of some Southern Poverty Law Center mantra, but it is nonetheless the state motto. Still.
Absolutely. I want to thank you again, Matt, for joining us, and we appreciate you.
Thank you for having
being
me.
A friend of the show and supporting us. Check us out next week.